Okay, hello students. Good morning to all of you. So I think most of you are present today, but I think just around three of you are absent, but maximum number of students are already there now in class. So I think we'll begin with the lecture. So last class, we learned about leadership and social service organizations. Of course, we, I introduced the subject to you. We saw the introductory aspects of leadership, the different leadership models. And today we are going to learn about, leadership and professionalism in social service organization. As you know, that professionalism has seeped into every sphere of, the corporate world. In fact, in every sphere of our lives and in every sphere of, the corporate world. Likewise, even in the social service sector, professionalism has seeped in. And today we have professionals who are handling even the social service sector. Without much wasting of time, we'll just directly go to our slides and see the nexus between professionalism and leadership and how the world has evolved, or the social service sector has evolved, or even the world has evolved to accept social service system as a profession. Okay. This is a short chapter, so you should not be having much difficulty in understanding this. So the second chapter is professional turfs in social and human service organizations. We'll see what is human service organization. I believe that by now you're already acquainted to the term human service organization by virtue of you being master of social service. However, even in our discussion, I'll just try to touch upon the aspect of human service organization as well, or what is human service. A professional corporate sector are indispensably organized and structured, as we already know that. Similarly, in recent years, the social service and human service dichotomy has evolved in the sense that they started, initially it was just social service, and later on this concept of human services came. And so there was this dichotomy and it branched into, they called human service, and part of it, as a subset of it, they said that there is social service. I'm repeating, they said they started calling it as human service, and as a subset of it, they said there is social service. So in the recent years, the social service and human service dichotomy evolved, and advanced social service or even human service is actually of ancient origin and has always existed since time immemorial. Now, social service, of course, is not a new concept as far as our memory goes, or even from time immemorial, rather, it has always existed, where man always wanted to help another person. The characteristic of helping another person is normally in a human being. So that has always existed. And social service does not just confine itself to, just helping someone, but it is towards the betterment of the society. So, however, it has certainly evolved into an organized field of work today, with several organizations that have mushroomed across the globe, and universities, of course, you're studying as well, offering courses in the sphere, bearing both international and domestic mandates. So social service, as opined by Herbert L.A., he says that it is a profession as well as business. But mind you, Herbert called it as a profession way back in 1925. So social service, way back in 1925, Herbert L.A., he opined that social service is a profession as well as a business. This is the term that he referred to social services. So he said it could be, you could refer to it as a profession, you could refer to it as a business, and thereby is well legislated and regulated. There are several laws pertaining to social service sector and how, like for example, funding. So, it's well regulated. So there are different laws that are available even in this sphere, and the social service sector is well regulated. Now, human service and social service. Social services are one of the many subcategories or subset of human services. Now, the goal of human service is to aid in providing basic human needs, whereas the foremost mission or the top priority of social service is to create an equitable society by strategizing obliteration of social evils or removal of social evils or uprooting of social evils, such as, you know, poverty, or they would normally deal with poverty eradication, or, you know, run literacy campaigns or amelioration of housing crisis or reducing housing and shelter issues, provision of clean water and so on, thereby catering to the socially disadvantaged section of the society. Now, Herbert L.A. 1923 in his treatise, What is Professional Social Work, opined that social work is the business, he says, of producing, changing, or adjusting social organization and procedure in the interest of human welfare according to scientific standards. Note here, he has used the word according to scientific standards. So it does not mean just help, but it goes beyond where there are certain standards that are established and the social service sector or social workers are regulated by those specific standards. So social worker, he says, may be called a business because it has become a specified or specialized occupation or a profession. Now, what is the example of human service where we said the subset of human service is social service? The example of human services would be food supply for families who have lost their jobs during the COVID-19 pandemic. So, I believe in every country, the drive began when during COVID, especially at its inception stage, when it was, it really broke the world and really it hampered business across the globe, where people lost their jobs and couldn't provide for their families. So this food supply drives were like in most countries, and it was widely prevalent even in UAE, where, you know, families who lost their job, there were, you know, social organizations who came up, or, you know, even certain religious organization or the churches, they got together, and families who still had jobs went and supported the families who lost their jobs, who couldn't pay their rents for 3 to 4 months, and so on and so forth. So food supply, this is an example of human service. So food supply for families who have lost their jobs due to COVID-19 pandemic is one example for you of human service. So human service organizations, they serve as a faucet of cleansing the pernicious impact of social evils as well. That means it serves as, you know, a fountain of cleansing the harmful impact, the pernicious impact of social evils, such as, for example, prostitution. Now, speaking about prostitution, of course, just for your knowledge, that laws vary from one jurisdiction to another. So human service also, an example of it would be where social workers try to, help, you know, people or women who engage themselves in, in prostitution. You see, it's because in some parts of the world, in certain jurisdiction, prostitution is not considered illegal. For example, prostitution is not entirely, or I wouldn't say it is illegal in India per se. Example, however, certain acts, of course, are considered as an offense under the Indian Penal Code and other allied laws prevalent in India, such as trafficking of women or girls, or flesh trade is, of course, a punishable offense. Now, again, giving an example of USA, it is illegal. Prostitution is illegal in most parts of USA. However, it is legitimized in 10 counties of Nevada. So prostitution, again, is illegal and regulated in Germany. It is considered as legal. Now, see the difference here. In USA, it is considered as illegal in most parts of USA. Try to mute your mic when you enter the classroom always. So prostitution is legal and regulated in Germany, Canada, Greece, etc. So the human rights of such workers, however, in such trade are upheld and certainly not negated. So human service organizations come to the aid of such workers as well, and their human rights are upheld irrespective of whether it is legal or illegal in any particular jurisdiction, depending upon whether it's illegal or legal in any particular jurisdiction of the world. For example, I remember a case in India where there was this police officer who you know, trespass the privacy of a woman, in the sense he, of course, you understand, he raped her, and there was a case, and then, of course, a criminal offense. Rape is a criminal offense in every part of the world. I mean, it has to be proved. So in India, so there was this police officer who raped a woman who was actually, you know, a part of a brothel. You know, she was in this flesh trade. So what? So he tried to trespass her privacy, and then she files a police complaint, and then the matter went up to the court. So the contention or the defense of the police officer, or rather I would say that the defense that was put up by his counsel before the court, was that, well, she is a woman of easy virtue, so she is not really entitled to the right of privacy. So, but then the court held that every human being, whether, you know, every human being for that matter, is entitled to a right of privacy, and therefore right of privacy, you know, should not be trespassed, and therefore the court gave her her rights, and the offense was established against the police officer. So human rights of workers in such trade, for example, are upheld irrespective of whether it is legal or illegal. The facts and circumstances of certain cases or in any particular jurisdiction of the world is an example of human service. Next is social service and human service organization structure. Like, what is the organization structure? Like corporate organization structure, it is similar to that, but it varies again a little bit. It depends upon the type of organization it is, that is a social service organization it is, and so on, depending upon whether it's a philanthropic organization, whether it's a charitable organization, nonprofit organization, NGO, non-governmental organization, and under, you know, which law it is established. So it depends. So the challenges of social service and human service sector has envisaged the need for professionalism to be integrated into the supportive social human service practice environment. Sustainable development models, of course, are established within the modern social service sector as well, and human service organizations. Now, professionalism breeds a structured mechanism of working, or I would rather say that professionalism calls for a structured mechanism of working. As we said earlier in the beginning of this class, we said that professionalism has seeped into even the social service sector. So it has gone beyond the mere term of helping one another or helping the society. So social workers are just not called as the helpers in the society, but they are like integrated into the social fabric to the extent that they are professionals. And you know, even Hurwitz says that, way back in 1925, mind you, he said that it is a profession, and it could be even called as a business because people are engaging themselves in that occupation. So professionalism breeds normally a structured mechanism of working, and it establishes the echelons of, you know, organizational structure. Leadership roles are integrated into the system as well. So there is a structural separation when it comes to social service and human service organization. There is normally a structural separation between various activities in the organization. For example, in the social service sector perspective, you would have a resource procurement activity. So that department would be a procurement department. Now that would be distinct from a service production activity where there are normally, the team workers, the field workers. So again, there would be a divide here between, a procurement department and, field workers. So further, there would be again a formal divide between the policy-making structure. So policy-making structure would include probably the top management, or there could be even a separate legal department there. And executive structure, again, there is again a divide between, a formal divide between the policy-making structure, the top management, including again the, probably they have even a legal department there, and then you have the executive structure. Now it depends upon the size of the organization, the mission, the vision of the organization, and the organization charter. So how the departments are actually divided. So again, depending upon in case if it is a quasi-governmental organization, then again, the structural divide would be between mandatorily, there would be a board there. If it is a quasi-governmental organization, that quasi is partly governmental organization, then the structural divide between the board, the management and executive, again, would be clearly demarcated and would be clearly reflected. Just give me a moment, please. I received a message, a chat message from one of you. Let me just check what it is. Okay. At the end of the class, I will ask you questions. And let me know whether you understand the subject or not, and how many of you feel that you're not able to quite catch up with me. Okay, we'll try to go slower as one of you has requested. So we were talking about the structural divide in a social service organization, depending upon the type of organization it is. Next is, again, the structural operation. Now, how does it operate? Generally, departments that are normally seen in a social service setup are the executive department, the administration department. I'm sure you're quite acquainted to it because you're already at the master's level now, and you've already, you have a background of social service. I'm quite sure of that. So you kind of understand the structural operation as well. However, theoretically, that you're learning now, again, practically, I'm sure you know it and you understand it and you're already acquainted to it theoretically as well, the other subjects. Well, now structural operation, of course, again, the divide between the executive department, the administrative department, the finance department, and the various field teams headed by the team leaders or project teams, depending upon the organizational theme and the purpose. So it depends upon what type of social service organization it is, what is the mission and the vision of the organization, whether it is a general social service organization which is trying to obliterate or root out every social evil, or they're just social service organization like an NGO that would, cater to the cause of any and every social evil that pops up. But sometimes it would be just a women's organization, or sometimes it is just women and childcare, or sometimes their main focus would be literacy, or their main focus would be establishing, because I've rendered classes even for philanthropic students who were part of a particular foundation. So they took these classes for, establishing, social service structure. So I remember how there was a particular team who used to go to the villages to, to set up clean water system. So it depends upon, what type of organization, what is the mission, what is the vision of a particular social service organization or human service organization, whether it's... whether it is, try to mute your mic always. For instance, like, for example, if you talk about the finance department, so the finance department must deal with the fundraising procedures, solicit funding, and coordinate with the team on evaluation and reporting. So now, funding is an important aspect in a social service organization. Now, funding, of course, revolves around also certain laws. So there are certain laws that would regulate the procedure of funding. There would be a chairperson. Normally the finance department may have to coordinate with the fundraising chair. That is, a director would be there, who is a nonprofit board member, of course, who would be responsible for creating a fundraising plan, ensuring that the organization is effusively funded or, well-funded for the services that it provides. Next, they would have, of course, the contract or the legal department with contract negotiation. Then they would have the administrative department, the normal administrative works. Probably they would also work for with grants team and may have to deal with grant writing for foundations within the ambit of, you know, or within the purview of, within the ambit of, or within the borders of, simply speaking, of the relevant laws in coordination with the legal department. Apart from that, of course, well-established foundations would incorporate in their system, you know, the MIS system, that is a management information system, and other relevant systems or software systems to maintain, to record, to, you know, preserve data and to carry on their normal routine work within the organization. So you see here, generally speaking, you know, if you talk about, you know, a quasi-governmental social service organization, there would be the top management, the executive, and again, the other field officers, and so on. So the executive department would comprise of, again, the finance, there would be probably even the HR department there, then there would be an administrative department, and so on. So the finance department would work in coordination with the board, would be a non-profit board member, would be a fundraising chair, for example. So they would work with respect to funds. Apart from it, they would handle the general finances and so on. So this is just a general structure. So the structural operation in a social service organization there is just a thin hairline difference between the corporate sector and a social service sector, because the goals of social service organization is distinct from the normal corporate structure. Now, the in-house operation in a social service organization therefore varies. So the executive staff normally is not endowed with or is not granted with crucial decision-making capacity. However, it may be entrusted with high level of responsibilities. Are you understanding me? You know, normally, you know, crucial decision-making, for example, funding, crucial decision-making is normally taken, you know, it's decided by the top management. It's not always decided by the field workers. However, the field workers may be entrusted with a high level of responsibility relating to social projects, like, you know, in such a social organization setup, such as governmental NGOs and voluntary nonprofit social organizations, and likewise. So unlike for-profit organizations or the normal corporate world, so perquisites or perks, the additional benefits that are normally awarded in a corporate structure may not be really awarded to the team, and that is normally restricted in the social service organizations. The monetary benefits for effective delivery, again, are also not a prominent feature in such organization, unlike the corporate sector. So this is something that is, I would say, is lacking in the social service sector, because just as in the corporate sector, you know, employee morale is boosted and they have certain benefits. I believe, like, if you call it a profession today, and if you call it a business, like he says, Holbert says, so let us go ahead and also boost the morale of social workers and provide them also benefits, because normally monetary benefits, like how you get in the corporate sector, like the benefits that they are granted is normally not given to a social worker. So that social service organization workforce structure entails passionate workers who are leaders in themselves, specialists in the field, who are willing to deliver their best professionally within the organization's vision and mission. Now, what is the current trend with respect to gender structure? Of course, the preponderance of women, in the social service sector is not, you know, really unknown to us. Women have always played a pivotal or, a prominent role in the social service sector. However, today there is a fair representation of all genders, whether men or women or even binary genders. So the current trend in professional leadership in the social service sector, what's happening today? As it is observed that in the present day, the concept of collective leadership is widely prevalent in practice. Collective leadership, I'm talking about where everyone in the organization develop leadership skills. They are trained in certain skills and they all have a sense of responsibility of delivering it. They lead one another. They take the lead for a particular project. So there is a concept of collective leadership that is widely prevalent in practice in today's social service sector. So social worker team work in unison is conducive to good practice in the sector vis-a-vis the organizational context. So stakeholders as well join hands with such social venture groups and organization, which move has actually propelled emergent leadership roles in the field as social service professionals. Now, simply speaking, there are other corporate bodies or, you know, the stakeholders of huge corporate bodies who engage themselves in, you know, the social service sector. And they, you know, they set up foundations. For example, if you see Microsoft, Bill Gates, you have Bill Gates, foundation. He has a foundation. Bill Gates and I think she's Melinda Gates. So foundation, they have a foundation there. So the stakeholders of huge corporate sectors, normally they join hands, for a social cause with certain social venture groups and organization. And that has propelled actually emergent leadership roles in the field as social service professionals. Now, social work forums if you're entering, I'm sorry to interrupt you. If you're entering the class 30 minutes late, today maybe I would allow you, okay? I said last time the buffering, time that would be